All right. Well, good morning to everyone. Welcome out to the Lord's house on the Lord's day. Old man Winter just won't go away, will he? And so he's, I see we have a few folks in the house that slid their way in this morning. And so it's good to see you here with us today. And I hope many folks join us by the way of live stream. It is the Lord's day. And he's blessed us with all kind of beautiful snow, and we do live in the mountains, and so we thank God for that and the safety to get here, and we're glad to see you. So we're going to have service now and after a while as well. So let's get our hearts and minds clear, and let's worship the Lord today. Amen. Lord's been good to us, and Tommy's here. So we're going to sing together. Let's stand, and we'll sing together, Trust and Obey. So let's stand and sing this morning.
When we walk with the Lord in the light of His Word, what a glory He sheds on our way. While we do His good will, He abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey. Trust and obey. For there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Not a shadow can rise, not a cloud in the skies, but His smile quickly drives it away. Not a doubt nor a a sign or a prayer can abide while we trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Not a burden we bear, not a sorrow, but our toil He doth quickly repay. Not a grief or a loss, not a frown or a cross, but is blessed if we trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy but to trust and obey. But we never can prove the delights of His love until all on the altar we lay. For the favor He shows and the joy He bestows are for them who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Then in fellowship sweet, we will sit at His feet, or we'll walk by His side in the way. What He says we will do, where He sends we will go. Never fear, only trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus than to trust and obey.
And that's what we do. We trust the Lord and we obey what He says. Amen. And He takes care of the rest. Amen. You may be seated here this morning. And we're going to go to the Lord in prayer. I want you to continue to pray, Brother Joe. Good one. He is in Glenwood and there for rehab. So let's pray that they'll get things started for him and get things moving and so we can get him back on his feet. Amen. He's come through a whole lot. And so let's continue to pray for Joe and Sue as well. I received a call this, before I left the house a little while ago from Melanie Spangler. And they said that Brother Larry was coming home today. So we thank God for that. He's another one that's been, on the respirator and ventilator. And sometime later today, he's supposed to get home. So we thank the Lord for that. And so continue to pray for him as he comes home. And then others, Mary Jo, your brother.
He's still on the ventilator. They've been trying to get him off, but his mind is falling like where he won't follow commands. He'll open his eyes. And so they take him off the sedation, and then they have to put him back on.
Yeah.
So he just had a bath.
Well, let's pray for Mike. Thompson today in the hospital as well, yes. Okay, yes, somebody told me that a while ago. Dr. Paul Gilley passed away yesterday, I think. Wasn't it yesterday? Dr. Gilley passed away. So let's remember the Gilley family this morning and Jerry Ray. Stacy, how's Sam?
He's this morning.
Oh, is he? Well, we'll praise the Lord for that. And Delma? Yeah. Well, amen. Well, praise the Lord for that. Answer prayer. Amen. Yes, ma'am. Annie, yes, pray for Annie. Annie's not feeling real good this morning. So let's remember her. Anybody else?
My son-in-law, Dave,
when
he was in Japan.
Uh-huh.
He just had a pretty serious hernia surgery. It's in quite a bit of pain. Just pray that that would heal quickly.
Okay. David Harvey. Okay, let's remember that request.
Pray for Bonnie. She's not feeling well
this morning. Okay, Bonnie Matherly, remember her. Today, anybody else? Okay, Gene Wilfong. Okay.
For David Stouffer.
Okay, David Stouffer. Pray for him.
He doesn't seem to be
getting any better. Well, let's pray for him today, for healing today. Anybody else?
John Wellman.
John Wellman? Oh, yes. Yeah. He had an accident yesterday in a basketball game in Roanoke today. So let's remember John Wellman. Well, unspoken requests? God knows our need today. Let's remember the lost. Let's pray for our nation. Our nation needs prayer. Continue to lift our president up and those folks serving our nation today. We need to pray for them. Ask for God's healing upon our land and God's forgiveness upon our land today. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Our Father, which art in heaven, O God, as we gather in the house of the Lord on this another Lord's Day, this beautiful day, God, you've given to us this day. Thank you, God, for the opportunity and the safety that you give us to be in the house of God today. And for those that are here in the building, Father, we thank you for them and those that are listening from the safety of their home this morning. We pray, Father, for a blessing, for them to receive a blessing today from the Word of God and from all of the things that will take place here in the house of God today. We thank you for a warm place together. And Father, we just thank you for men and those that's been out this morning to make the place safe for us to be able to be here. And we just ask you, Lord, to bless them and give them safety today. Father, those working out on the highways, and we ask you, Lord, to watch over and protect them. Father, we pray. And Lord, we just thank you, God, that you're always present to meet with us every time we come in the house of God. And Lord, you promised to never leave us nor forsake us. You promised together with us, Lord, at all times. And Father, we just thank you for that. We just love you, and Father, we pray you forgive us, Lord, of our sin. And Father, as we said already this morning, we pray for our nation, God, that's in need of healing. Pray, Father, for our leadership of our nation today. Lord, those who are making decisions, we ask you, God, that you'll be with them, Father, and heal their heart and save their soul. And Father, we just pray that you forgive our nation, Lord, their sin. Father, how we have strayed from the right way. And God, I just pray, Lord, you'll straighten that mess out. And Father, we just pray for the church today and people of the church that will keep our focus, God, in the right place. We thank you, God, for your watch care of the church and how you took care of us through these difficult times. And we know you'll do the same, Father, even the further along as we go. And Father, we pray for these many needs that's been mentioned here today. Lord, there's been many folks suffering from sickness. today. We pray for Brother Joe and the rehab that you'll be with him, Father. We pray that they can be able to help him, Father, to walk. Pray for Sue this morning. Pray for Brother Larry Spangler. Thankful, Lord, today that he's coming home. Father, we just ask you, Lord, to be with him as they bring him home, give him safety. And we just pray, Father, for them. We pray for Brother Sam. And Lord, we're thankful to hear that he's going to preach this morning in his church. Lord, we thank you for healing. Thank you, God, for just being ever-present, God, to help your people. We pray for David Stauffer today. Lord, that you heal his mind. And God, help him, Father, as the devil's raising an attack upon him and his family. God, we ask you to be, Lord, with them today. And we pray for these other requests. We pray for David Harvey today and Bonnie Matherly, that you be with her. And Lord, we pray for Mike Thompson this morning. We ask you, Father, to intervene on his behalf for healing today, Father, we pray. For Gene Wilfong and his family, and Lord, for John Wellman today in the hospital in Roanoke at this accident. We pray, Father, for him. And Jerry Ray, and we ask for help for him. And Father, we pray for the family of Paul Gilley this morning. That you'll comfort them, Lord, in the loss of a loved one. Comfort them, God, with the only comfort that there can be, and that's your comfort today. And Father, others that's been requested here this morning, we pray for those needs. We ask you to save our lost people. We ask for revival in our land. God, bring that revival among us. Let it start with us, that they might see revival in me. Now, Father, bless our service today. Bless Stacy as she comes to sing. Father, bless the preaching of thy word this morning. And Lord, we just pray that somewhere a soul will be reached and lives will be touched. Christians will be encouraged. Souls will be saved. Now, Father, we just ask you, Lord, to fill us with your words today that we might reach people. People need to be reached today for the gospel of Jesus Christ. Forgive us, God, of our sin. Heal us and help us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And amen. All right, Stacy, you come and sing a song for us now. She'll come back in a moment. Sing another one. All right.
Savior really cares for you today. If he hung the moon, I know he will help you. If he holds the sparrow in flight, he'll hold.
If you'll stand with me, let's sing, I Am Thine, O Lord. Where thou hast died.
There will be some of you young folks that are here. There will be a junior church class. Brother Gary's taking care of that. So you young folks, head that away if you want to. All righty. Well, today, our dollar for mission offering, this is a fifth Sunday, so we've been designating most of them, when the preacher remembers, to our building fund. And so what is received in our dollar for missions today will go towards the debt we have in our building fund. And so you'll be praying for that. And, of course, we're coming up on another anniversary year of our Faith in Action program. You'll be hearing more about that now pretty soon as we'll be embarking in another campaign. We got to keep this campaign rolling until we get that building paid for. Amen. The Lord's been good to us. We've already exceeded what was committed for last year, and we still have till June for that. So we praise God for that. God takes care of us, doesn't he? We'll remain faithful. God is faithful. And so what we receive today goes toward that, toward the building fund. And so you give to that as you leave. And if you folks at home want to send something in, you be sure you designate it for that so we'll know where the proper place to put it. Okay? And so it's just exciting. You know, it's exciting to serve the Lord. And one thing I've learned, it just gets more exciting the further we go. Amen. When we see everybody else falling apart and the world falling apart, it ought to excite us to serve God. Because God ain't falling apart. Amen. God knows exactly what he's doing. And so it's an exciting time. And God's doing great things. And I'm looking for great things to come even this year. All right, Stacy, you come right back and do another song for us. Then we're going to get in the Word of God this morning.
Time, oh man.
Amen. Amen. And that's where we're headed. Amen. That's right. Thank you, Stacy. And thank you, Pastor Mays and Tommy. And just to see Kim and Jerry back there driving the Ford. And Debbie up there in the crow's nest operating the video. It takes people to work at work, doesn't it? And I appreciate people willing to work and to make it work. We're not perfect. If we was, we wouldn't be here. Amen. But God is, and I'm glad He is. Yeah, so we'll just depend on Him. All right, we're in the book of Revelation this morning. Revelation chapter number 19. We have touched on part of this already. We touched last week on the first 10 verses and the marriage supper of the Lamb. Now the purging of the earth has took place. And of course we're going to have some more purging coming up. God is going to completely annihilate, get rid of the evilness in this world that is so prone today and so thick today in leadership and everywhere we see evilness everywhere. And, you know, it just irritates me to watch people be proud of evilness and watch them congratulate each other and hug each other and love on each other for the evilness that is going on. You see, and as I was studying, I had for the lesson for Sunday school this morning, and I'll give that to you next time. But I thought about, you know, we get all caught up sometimes in watching people parade around in evilness and in your face kind of things today, and they want you to, you know, take it all up. But here's the thing: as Michael contended with the devil over the body of Moses. You ever read that passage of Scripture and study it? That's what we're going to talk about in Sunday school. But he would not make a railing accusation against Satan. Did you notice that? He wouldn't speak against him. He wouldn't speak anything contrary to him. He said, God will take care of that. God will rebuke him. Why do you say that, preacher? Today, you and I, we can't. Now, I'm going to say this, and I'm going to be in trouble at the get-go. But you can't be a Christian and be happy with what's going on. Amen? Can you? But what are we to do about it? I can't rebuke it. God's going to take care of it. Amen? And so as we come to Revelation chapter 19, and we've seen now, we went through all this tribulation period, and last week we looked at the marriage supper of the Lamb and the celebration going on in heaven. But in verses 11 through the remainder of this chapter, we're going to see the second coming of Christ. This is not the rapture. The rapture has already took place. But His return to earth. Amen. His coming back again to set foot upon this earth. And you see, that old slewfoot, the devil, is going to be in this party. Amen. The false prophet's going to be in this party, as we're going to see in our scripture today. You see, we saw last week where he said, look at verse 9 again. For it said, right, blessed are they which are called unto the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he saith unto me, these are the true sayings of God. This is what God has said, and this is the true sayings of God. Man didn't say this. Man didn't write this. God said this. Now, man says a whole lot, and man takes the Bible and messes it plumb up and interprets it the wrong way. But what God said, God said. And what God said, God means. You see, we tend to forget that today, that God's already said it, God's already wrote it, and God's going to take care of it. I understand it's very easy to get caught up in the workings of our world today. It's very easy to get caught up in worry and weariness. I understand that. I get caught up in it myself, and I get to worrying and wondering. But what I got to remind myself, God's already wrote it.
God's already penned it. God's already took care of it. And he's not going to go away from this book one bit. He's already took care of it. And so we've got to learn to lay it in the hands of God and do what God has commissioned us to do, even in these last days. Days of uncertainty. Now we see the second coming of Christ. And let's begin verse 11 this morning. And I saw heaven open, John speaking here. And behold, a white horse. And he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he doth judge and make war. Now, we've seen a man on a white horse earlier. You remember? I think you go back to chapter 6. It was a man on a white horse who had a bow without any arrows. You remember? And he was coming to conquer. That wasn't Christ. That was the Antichrist. The false Christ. The Christ that the false Christ, the false God that the world fell in love with. Amen. The one that came promising victory and had no victory. The one that's getting ready to be defeated here in these upcoming verses, you see. The one that most of the world will put their trust in. Amen. You understand what I'm saying? It's the false Christ. But this is the real Christ. You see, we come to verse number 11. John sees now all of heaven opened up. And the Lord Jesus sitting upon a white horse. And by the way, this time, you know, Christ came to this earth the first time. You remember? Remember when he came? He came as a baby, born in Bethlehem. You see, he came and he suffered the ridicule of this world. You see, this time the Lord Jesus is coming as a warrior king to rule and to reign and to set right the wrong. The first time he came as a servant. You understand that instead of a crown, they gave him a cross. Amen. You see, and instead of glory, they gave him ridicule. You see, he came as a servant the first time. But this time, he's coming as king. He's coming as king to rule and to reign. Notice John says he's called what? Faithful. You know what that means? You know what faithful simply means? That means one trustworthy. Amen. That means one that is going to do what he says. He's faithful to the things he said. He's trustworthy. He can be relied upon. You can trust this one. Amen. Can I tell you, the first one that rode in on the white horse was a liar. Couldn't trust him. For he deceived the nations and he deceived the people, and many will spend eternity in hell with him because they were deceived by him. But this one comes as faithful. This one comes as trustworthy. John says again that he's faithful and true. You can count on him. And he says, and in righteousness he doth judge and make war. You see, he's coming and he has a right to do what he's going to do. He's going to operate in righteousness, and in righteousness he'll judge the wickedness of this world. Amen. Hey, there's going to be people that's going to be bowing their knees and begging for God to have mercy upon them at a moment when mercy is no longer to be found, and when judgment has set down upon this world. Let me tell you, the one coming on the white horse here is the real thing. Amen. The King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He's genuine and he's real. Now notice in verse 12, his eyes were as a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns, and he had a name written that no man knew but he himself. His eyes were as a flame of fire. You know what that means? It means his eyes will look at all the evilness and bring it to an end. Eyes of divine judgment. eyes of righteous judgment, you see. For he will judge the wickedness of this world. We've already seen the great whore put down. And he will come and judge the wickedness of this world. The Bible says he has on his head many crowns. By the way, can I tell you something? The world gave him a crown of thorns, didn't he? They crowned him with a crown of thorns. But this time, his crown won't be of thorns. You know what it'll be of? It'll be of royalty. It'll be of victory. Amen? You see, he's going to have a victorious crown. He's going to have a royal crown. And the Bible says that he's going to have a name that only he knows. A new name that only is known by himself. And no doubt John must have seen that name. You know, the Bible tells us, Paul told us that no doubt what John sees, that name, I believe it's the name that Paul said was a name that is above all names. Amen. Philippians chapter 2 and verse number 9, the Bible says, wherefore God hath highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus Christ every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess, amen, that he is Lord to the glory of God the Father. What kind of name is it? It's a hallelujah name. It's a name that everyone will call. He has a name, you see. The name, only he knows. But it'll be a royal name, a name of victory, a highly exalted name. Name like no other name, you see. Verse number 13. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name was called the Word of God. Now, I want you to understand something. That this vesture that's dipped in blood, understand this time, it's not his blood. Amen. You see, his blood was shed on the old rugged cross. He shed his blood so you and I wouldn't have to shed our blood. Amen. He shed his blood so you and I could have victory over death, hell, and the grave. Now he's coming back, and the Bible says that on his vesture, he's clothed in a vesture that he is dipped in blood. This blood's not his own blood this time, but the blood of his enemies. He will go to deliver Israel that has been in hiding, and he will bring victory to God's people. And it'll be the blood of those that stood against him. It'll be the blood of those people that shook their fist at him. It'll be the blood of those that run his name into the ground. It'll be the blood of those that blasphemed his name. It'll be the blood of those that murdered the babies and was proud of it. It'll be the blood of those that was against God. That'll be on his vesture. Won't be his own blood. His blood was shed at Calvary. They didn't want that. You see, they turned that aside. They pushed that. They blasphemed that. They made fun of that. They didn't want that. I find it interesting. Let me read to you some things that Isaiah said. In Isaiah chapter 63, I'm going to read a few verses for you this morning. But Isaiah, here's what he said about this. He says, who is this that cometh from Edom? With dyed garments from Bozrah. This is this that is glorious in his apparel, traveling in the greatness of his strength. I that speak in righteousness, mighty to save. Wherefore art thou red in thine apparel, and thy garments like him that treadeth in the wine fat? I have trodden the winepress alone, and of the people there was none with me, for I will tread them in mine anger. And trample them in my fury, and their blood shall be sprinkled upon my garments. And I will stain all my raiment. For the day of vengeance is in mine heart, and the year of my redeemed is come. And I looked, and there was none to help, and I wondered that there was none to uphold. Therefore mine own arm brought salvation unto me in my fury. It upheld me, and I will tread down the people in mine anger, and make them drunk in my fury, and I will bring down their strength to the earth. You see, the final battle belongs to the Lord. You know, we often wonder, and sometimes I wonder, Lord, why aren't you taking care of this right now? Why is things allowed to go on the way they are? You ever wonder that? I wonder that sometimes. Why do we see all this corruption going on? And why is it allowed to happen? Look what they're doing to your holy name. But you know what? It's not for me to try to figure out. What I've got to do is trust what God has said. You see, the day of the vengeance of the Lord is coming. Here's what I've got to do for myself. Make sure that I'm in the crowd following him. Amen. Not in the crowd, in the wine press. Because there's going to be a crowd in the wine press. You'll see. I don't want to be in that crowd. And so, we see that his garment is dipped in blood. And also it says, and his name is called the Word of God. Now, I'm going to tell you something. Can I tell you how he's going to conquer everything? How he's going to win everything? He's going to do it by the very words of his mouth. By the very Word of God that he's given you and I today. You see, this very Word will silence the enemy. This very Word will shut the devil up. Amen. And by the way, Satan knows that. Satan already knows his demise. He knows where he's headed. He knows this day is coming. You see, but what is his job today? His job is to convince you and I this day is not coming. He's trying to convince the church today to give up, give out, give in. Amen. Yes, and you're going through hard times. You shouldn't be going through hard times. Your God shouldn't be taking you through hard times. Can I tell you, that's the voice of the devil. Here's the sad part. Many people are falling, pray tell, to that. Many people are listening to the voice of the devil. Verse 14, the armies. Now look at this. And the armies which were in heaven followed him. Upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean. No blood on them garments. Amen. No blood there. Amen. You see, the army that we will be returning with Christ will include, and this is what I believe, it will include the angels, it will include the church, it will include the Old Testament saints, the tribulation saints, those who have put their faith and trust in Jesus Christ. Amen. You see, that'll be the armies of God, and we'll be following behind the chief priest, the high priest, the great I am, the blessed one. We'll be following behind him. And the Bible says, I'll have my own white horse. Amen. Hey, I've never rode a white horse. Have you ever? One of these days, the Bible says, I'll get me one, and I'm going to ride on it behind the King of Kings. Amen. Look what kind of clothes he's going to give me. Brand new ones. Amen. White and clean. No blood on them garments. You know why? He took the battle on himself. Amen. You see, amen. He's still going to take care of the battle. I believe he's just telling us, ride along, children. You've been through the weariness long enough. You've been through the valley long enough. You just ride along. You be the cheerleaders, and you watch what's going to happen. Amen. I'll take care of it. You just keep preaching. You just keep singing. You just keep praying. You just keep being faithful. I'll take care of it. Don't you quit now. Come too far now to quit. Amen. It's not time to give up and shut the door. It's time to praise God who's going to win. Huh. They're clothed in fine linen, white and clean. No blood on their garments. Christ is going to do the fighting. Verse 15. And out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword. Word of his mouth. Now look here, what he's saying. Out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, that with it he should smite the nation. And he shall rule them with a rod of iron. He treadeth the winepress, the fierceness, and the wrath of Almighty God. Christ will consume the enemies simply with the word of his mouth. Amen. What is his weapon? His weapon is our weapon. You understand what I'm saying? The same thing that he's going to fight with, you and I fight with today. You know what that is? The word of God. Amen. Why do you think they hate the Bible so much? Why do you think they hate preaching of the word of God so much? Because it's powerful. And it's sharp. And it brings down. You see, it quietens the enemy. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse 8. Bible says, and then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth, and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming. Oh, what a time. Bible says he will rule with a rod of iron. His rule will be in total authority. They can't do anything with him. He's coming to rule and reign. You see, that rod reminds us today of the shepherd. You remember the shepherd with that rod, how he would control those sheep with that rod. Remember when we talked about the rod and how with that rod, he had that rod of accuracy, you see, and he could control those sheep with that rod of accuracy. You see, that's what the word of God's going to be, a rod of accuracy. It's going to keep the way of righteousness. He's going to set in order all righteous. Let me read to you Psalm 23, verse 3 and 4. It says, he restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. You see, the rod of the shepherd, he's going to rule and reign with that powerful rod. Remember, we went through the 23rd Psalm one time. We talked about that shepherd. And that shepherd was in complete control of that rod. You remember? He could throw it with accuracy. Remember, we talked about those sheep that were hard-headed, bull-headed sheep, ones that wouldn't listen, ones that were butting everybody else. We got some butters. Amen. People that want their way and butt their way through society and threaten other people and try to get what they want by force. And by the way, that's what's going on in our world today. Our government's butting us around. Amen. But the shepherd had a rod of accuracy. That old sheep could go to butting and being stubborn, and he could throw that rod. You know what that rod would do? It'd knock him down. Put him back on track. Let me tell you what's going to happen. He says he'll rule with a rod of iron. Huh? Accuracy. He's going to rule with his accuracy. And they're not going to be able to do anything about it. You see, their power will mean nothing. Their words will mean nothing. There's a different ruler has stepped on the scene. You see. Amen. The executive pens won't have no power in this day. By the way, I got one. Did y'all know that? Hey, I should have brought it in and showed it to you. I was brought an executive pen. I love it. It doesn't mean anything, but I love it. You see, accuracy is the way he's going to rule. Complete destruction of those who try to destroy God and his people. You see, God is going to win. So we see his ruling, and he's going to tread the winepress of the fierceness of the wrath of Almighty God. Verse 16. And he hath on his vesture and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He has his rightful reign, you see. 1 Timothy 6 and 15, which in these times he shall shew who is the blessed and only potentate, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Can I tell you, there's going to be no confusing who this is. Amen. They're going to know beyond a shadow of a doubt. And no doubt many people are going to beg and cry and say, this is the one we've heard about. This is the one we were warned about. This is the one they preached about. This is the one that we've denied. This is the one, you see. Are they going to love him? No, they're going to hate him even the more. They're going to hate him even the more. Now, verse 17, there's an invitation put out. Notice in verse 17. And I saw an angel standing in the sun. John speaking here. And he cried with a loud voice, saying to all the fowls that fly in the midst of heaven, come and gather yourselves together unto the supper of the great God. Verse 17, we have an invitation to the flesh-eating birds, the vultures. You see, those that will defile flesh and eat flesh. Why is an invitation being given? Because there's going to be plenty to eat in just a little bit. Amen. You see, they're going to come and they're going to do their part in cleaning up the mess. You know, an old buzzard. You ever watch a buzzard? If something dies in the field, you know, you see all these birds circling around. You know what they're doing? They're devouring their flesh. It takes not very long at all. If you got several of them circling, you go back and you don't have anything left but a pile of bones. Why, they've come for supper, haven't they? The invitation now is made by the angel to the flesh-eating vultures and buzzards and all those kind of birds to come to the feast. You're invited to come and partake. There's going to be plenty. You say, preacher, it sounds cruel. I'm going to tell you what it is. It's the righteous judgment of God. For too long, they have belittled God. They have pulled God down, made fun of God. Now it's time. It's God's time. Amen. It's a scary time, but only for those that don't believe in Christ. Verse 18, that ye may eat the flesh of the kings, and the flesh of captains, and the flesh of mighty men, and the flesh of horses, and of them that sit on them, and the flesh of all men, both free and bond, both small and great. You see, what a time's coming upon this old earth. But God's cleaning it up. Why is God cleaning up? He's got a new heaven and a new earth that we're going to get into for too long. He's going to bring in upon this earth. Verse 19. Notice what he does now. He deals with the beast. And I saw the beast and the kings of the earth and their armies gathered together to make war against him that sat on the horse and against his army. Now you understand, we see people, there's a whole congregation of people that has sided with the beast. They've sided with the false prophet. They have sided with Satan. And now they're going to gather together to make war against this man that rides upon this white horse and their armies, and they're going to try to fight him. By the way, they're going to join with Satan up until the very end. You see how bad in our world today that Satan has convinced people that he's the right way. But you see, the problem is Satan's a liar. If Satan was to tell the truth, you know what he'd have to tell him? Oh, I'm not going to win. We're not going to win this thing. Matter of fact, we're going to lose. But Satan didn't operate that way. Don't you wish he would look us in the face and tell us the truth? It doesn't. He'll look you in the face and lie to you. Promise you great things, and I'll give you great things, and make things come to pass in your life. At the same time, he's dooming you to damnation. How do you get a world to understand that? You preach the gospel. That Jesus Christ came to seek and to save that which was lost. We don't have to side with the enemy. We don't have to believe the enemy. We don't have to live in 2021 scared to death of man. Amen. We can live believing God and know that God's going to have the victory. You see, I don't know what else to say. But just believe God. Get on God's side. He goes on to say in verse 20, and the beast was taken. Now notice this. The ones they followed. And the beast was taken, and with him the false prophet that wrought miracles before him, with which he deceived them that had received the mark of the beast and them that worshipped his image. These both were cast alive into a lake of fire burning with brimstone. You see, the destination of the beast and the false prophet, and by the way, the beast and the false prophet fed off of Satan. Now, Satan's going to be dealt with in chapter 20. This is not Satan. This is the beast, which we call the Antichrist, and the false prophet. You see, they're being dealt with here. You see, they deceived the people and they lied to the people. They were working off of Satan, and they were given powers by Satan, the beast and the false prophet. And they were working off of Satan, and they deceived many, and they talked them into taking the mark of the beast, and they talked them into following them. And that's exactly where they're going to follow him, in the very place that we see them cast today. The Bible says they were cast where? Alive into a lake of fire burning with brimstone. You see, that's their destination. And everyone that'll follow them. You see, the angels that follow Satan, that's their destination. The people that'll follow Satan, that's their destination. The ones that will not believe God, that's their destination. You see. Now, verse 21, and the remnant were slain with the sword of him that sat upon the horse, which sword proceeded out of his mouth, and all the fowls were filled with their flesh. You see, once the beast and the false prophet is dealt with, then God's going to consume the rest with the power of his word. How important it is that you and I know what God's word says. How we should spend time every day finding out what God says. Amen. And set our minds to put our trust in the God who gave us these promises. You see, God's not a fairy tale. Can I tell you, Satan's not a fairy tale. He's real. His deception is very real. He's a trickster. He knows how to deceive. He knows how to lie. He's very good at it. It's very convincing what he says. But he's not telling you the truth. Because if he did, he'd have to tell you about this day. And in chapter 20, we're going to see Satan bound. Bound up, you see. God's going to take care of the evilness, folks. I was thinking, you know, I get in conversation sometimes with people. Sometimes they ain't very good. And, you know, and we, and I try to be very careful. Because what I want to say, I'm not supposed to say. I'm just being honest with you. Amen. When I'm asked my opinion about our president, I'm asked several times. I have to be very careful because I can't say what I want to say. I have to say what I think God would want me to say. Amen. And this is what I say. God will take care of that.
Amen. I don't endorse nothing. I just say God will take care of that. And that's exactly what he'll do. Amen. God will have the final say. They don't care what this preacher said. Well, let me say it this way. The only thing they care about what this preacher says is if I give them the word of God, it convicts them, that makes them mad. Otherwise, they don't care. They don't even know I exist. And that's okay. But God will take care of it. Amen. And so I have to be very careful when you hear all these things and you get all this news and you get all this stuff going through your head and you don't know whether to believe half of it or not. We just got to trust God. We've been reading in the book of Revelation what he said he's going to do. Do we believe that? Amen. Well, that's what he's going to do. Amen. And so I believe we're standing right at the dropping off point. I believe we're there. We're here. Amen. We're living in the days of Lot. Are we not? We're living in the days of Sodom and Gomorrah. We're living in the days of violence and evilness on every hand. We're in it. I don't think we have to wait for it to get here. It's here. So what is next, preacher? Well, the sound of that trumpet. Amen. Yeah. He's coming. And he came the first time and they ridiculed him, put him on a cross, gave him a crown of thorns. He came the first coming, will be when the trump of God sounds. Amen. And we get called out here. What we're reading here today will follow this tribulation period. And the saints of God has been raptured. And those that have died and have gone into heaven, their bodies will be raptured, you see. And then they're going to come back. Now we're going to step into a millennial reign of Christ. You see, that's when there'll be peace on the earth. I don't think we'll see it till then. We've just got to trust the Lord. Amen? Amen. You understand what we're saying today? And God gives us a picture here in the book of Revelation. The ones that remain, this final verse, the ones that remained, that took the mark of the beast and followed the beast and the false prophet, he says, will be slain by the word of God and eaten by the vultures. But see, that's not the end of them. You see, would be better for them if that was the end for them. Because they still got to face hell. Can I tell you what that is? That's eternal damnation. Separated forever from the presence of God. Oh my. How important is it that we stay true to God? It's very important. It's very important that we pray, seek God's face, pray for our lost people. Pray for our confused people. There's people confused today. That they've allowed Satan to confuse them. And we need to pray for them. Because we got to be in Christ. Got to be in Christ. Not halfway in. Not partway in. We have to be in Christ. You see, and in Christ is to trust Christ. To be halfway in is not to trust Christ. You can't halfway trust him. Either trust him or you don't trust him. You see. And so we need to be busy praying. Our Father, Lord, we thank you today for giving us time in the Word of God this morning. And Lord, we just ask that you settle in hearts of people, especially if somebody today is not saved. I believe time is quickly running out for the day of salvation. I pray for maybe somebody's listening this morning. Say, preacher, I'm not saved. I need to be saved. Lord, I pray you'll deal with their hearts today. And those that are in the church house this morning, I pray for them. I know they got people in their families that's not saved, or even family members that are not all the way in. And Father, they need to get in Christ. I just pray, Father, stirring among our people. Pray for revival in our land. Lord, I know there's time left and the day of grace is still here. And Lord, you may have plans for many more days. But God, whatever it is, give us that spirit to pray for our people, seek your face, help us this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As he plays today, let's just take a moment. You need to pray for somebody, something, and you do so. Bring them before the throne of God today. Pray for them. Our Father, Lord, we thank you, God, for helping us today. We thank you, God, for being our faithful friend. Thank you, God, for the truth of your word. Lord, I pray for every prayer that's been prayed today. I pray, Father, you'll save our lost people. Reclaim backsliders. Get us on the battlefield for God. We read about the day of the Lord. Lord, help us to get many people out of this day. For our nation, God, we lift them before you with prayer. They need help. And we pray, God, you'll help them. Lord, I know you'll take care of the evilness. Lord, that's what you do. And God, you help us to remain faithful. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Y'all come back up here. Sorry, I should have told you to stay. Stand right up here with me. I make him look tall, don't I? Amen. Stacy, you and Marty come right up here and stand with us today. Amen. Well, this family's been attending church with us for a little while. I'm not sure how long, but
it's been a year now.
It's been a year, almost a year now. They've been coming faithfully to the house of God. And they've come forward today to join us in membership at our church. So Michael and Stacy and Marty, isn't it good to see families? Amen. Families in the church together, serving God together. And, you know, that's what it's all about. This is what the world doesn't like, but we like. Amen. And so they've come today for membership into our church. I'll get the paperwork to them so we can take care of all that. But what I want you to do is to stand today to receive them into our fellowship. And any of you deacons that are here this morning, come on and let's give them the right hand of fellowship and welcome them into our church family as a family. How we need our church family, don't we? Serving God. Debbie, you have any of those forms?
I'll get them to
see. Okay, we'll get them to you, okay? God bless you all. Thank you. That's wonderful. Bless you, girl. Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, we thank you all for being a blessing to us, and we hope to be a blessing to you down through the years to come. God bless you. You may go. Amen.
All right, you can be seated. We're going to go over a few announcements, a few things going on, and then we'll turn you loose. We will have church tonight at 6:30. I don't know if it's supposed to snow anymore or not. I just look out the window and see if it's snowing or not. And so so we'll have service 6:30 this evening, and a Bible study on Wednesday, book of Jeremiah, and what chapter are we in? 18. Jeremiah chapter 18. So keep that in mind as well. Okay. Oh, I do not know. Are we still scheduling a business meeting this evening?
We are.
Okay, yes. I'll make an announcement.
Well, if you noticed in your bulletins again today, you had the menu for the spaghetti dinner next week for our mission team. And so, again, it's donation only. We don't charge anything for that. But if you plan to attend, we ask that you fill that form out. That lets us know how many meals to prepare ahead of time and indicate on there how many's in your party, your name, and whether you want to dine in with us. You're welcome to do that, or if you want to carry out. So that'll help us streamline our operation. So, and that's for the mission team. Those of you mission team members that are still kind of hanging out there on the edge, I need to know by the end of today's business or no later next Sunday if you're still going on the mission trip. If you can't go, that's fine. We understand, and I have to get the house here soon. So please let us know if you can for that. School of the Bible will be this week. The paperwork's out there. Tuesday, Lord willing, we'll be back in here for our School of the Bible. Master Clubs Wednesday. For the Master Clubbers here coming up in April, we're going to be participating in the Pine Car Derby down at Rich Creek Baptist Church. And so Master Clubbers, those of you who haven't got cars, you need to come and see me to participate in that. And also here soon, we will be giving you some information and details on our youth rally choir when we will start practicing. God bless you.
Okay, so we will have our annual business meeting this evening. And so I'll be following the service tonight. And so you keep that in mind as we'll go over the budget and all for the upcoming year tonight as well. All right, anything I've missed? I don't know of anything, dude. It's the last day of January. Tomorrow's February. Amen. All righty, let's stand to be dismissed. Thank you for being here today in the house of God. Our Father, we thank you, God, for allowing us another opportunity to be here, Lord, on this day. Lots of snow on the ground, but Father, you gave us safety as we journeyed here. We pray for safety as we go home, and we ask you, Lord, to bring us back here after a while for church. It's the Lord's Day, and we honor and worship you. We pray, Father, that you'll give us a voice of testimony as we go out into the world, a world that is crying for help. And Lord, they need your help. And Father, forgive us, Lord, of our sin, and bless this day. We thank you for it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
This wondrous revelation, whosoever.